Although Michael Jackson had close relationships with at least four US presidents, both Republican and Democrat, the King of Pop never endorsed a presidential nominee or explicitly expressed his political leanings. In one sense, Jackson was morally conservative, pro-life, prioritized family values, religion, and capitalistic interests, amassing incredible wealth as a result of big business endorsements and corporate America. However, Michael also expressed deep concerns for the lives of children, the disadvantaged, and the environment, giving countless millions to causes to help those in need of socially more progressive programs. Michael increasingly called for global unity in his music, as he used his own influence to affect political change. But at the ballot box, how did the King of Pop ultimately vote? As the lead singer and youngest member of the Jackson 5, Michael Jackson was the group's focal point as they became one of the most popular family acts in music. He and his brothers were widely viewed as role models for contemporary society. Introduced during an era of multiculturalism and integration in media, they represented the American dream actualized post-desegregation as a result of the triumphs fought during the civil rights movement. Often portrayed as having risen out of black ghetto culture, the press celebrated them as a family founded on core religious beliefs and a strong work ethic. In 1972, the Jackson 5 even received a commendation from the US Congress in recognition of the brothers' contribution to American youth culture. Being raised as Jehovah's Witnesses, a religion that is apolitical by default, the group didn't necessarily engage in politics, but their impact on popular culture was innately a political act. This became more and more evident as Michael's career developed, and he broke through numerous racial barriers. Achieving the highest-selling album by a black artist, Off the Wall succeeded at a time when disco and R&B was perceived as inferior to rock by critics. In 1983, Billie Jean was the first music video by a black artist to be put into circulation on MTV, which previously had been a channel directed towards a white rock-orientated audience. The popularity of videos for Billie Jean, Beat It, and Thriller helped bring MTV nationwide fame. Jackson's success at the time was credited for rescuing the music industry from its late 1970s recession and revolutionizing it as initiating a marketing focus on blockbuster albums with video presentations. The success of his Thriller album not only broke down racial barriers in music, but also in other areas of contemporary society. Critic Greg Tate saying, quote, "Black people cherished Thriller's breakthrough, as it was their own battering ram against apartheid. It reintroduced black music into mainstream American radio. Until then, genre content philosophies introduced in the mid-1970s segregated music by race, limiting airplay of black music.
Call it disco or whatever, it's dance music. It's got the African drum rhythms like original, like rock and roll or disco, whatever, but it's dance music. And people shouldn't categorize it racially. It's for the whole world, because everybody dance."
Jackson, whose success was compared to that of Elvis Presley and the Beatles, broke down that system. Michael Jackson's first personal correspondence with the White House took place after the singer suffered third-degree burns while filming a Pepsi commercial in early 1984. A letter from the president, Ronald Reagan, to Michael Jackson, dated February the 1st, 5 days after the accident, read, "Dear Michael, I was pleased to learn that you were not seriously hurt in your recent accident. I know from experience that these things can happen on set, no matter how much caution is exercised. All over America, millions of people look up to you as an example. Your deep faith in God and your adherence to traditional values are an inspiration to all of us, especially young people searching for something real to believe in. You've gained quite a number of fans along the road since I Want You Back, and Nancy and I are among them. Keep up the good work, Michael. We're very happy for you. Sincerely, Ronald Reagan." The Gloved One's incredible success was a refreshing change to the debaucherous lives that often characterized the world of rock and roll. Jackson's humble demeanor and commitment to God and clean living was in line with Reagan's righteous vision for America, where the diligent, hardworking man would ultimately triumph. As a result of this initial communication, talks started, and Michael for the first time aligned himself politically by allowing his music to be used in an anti-drunk driving campaign.
"Just get in, we'll talk about it.
I've got to go home."
"Oh, come on, Carrie. We're going to a new place.
Don't be a fool. she wants to go home, right?
Let's go.
Whoa! You okay to drive?
Yeah, I'm fine.
You sure?
Relax.
What's a few beers?
If you don't stop your friend from drinking and driving, you're as good as dead. Drinking and driving can kill a friendship.
As a result of this and other philanthropic efforts, on May 14, 1984, President Reagan presented the Presidential Public Safety Communication Award to Michael Jackson in front of the White House during a press conference that attracted thousands of onlookers.
Well, isn't this a thriller? And just think, you all came to see me. No, I know why you're here, and with good reason. To see one of the most talented, most popular, and most exciting superstars in the music world today, Michael Jackson. Michael, welcome to the White House. I hope you'll forgive me, but we have quite a few young folks in the White House who all wanted me to give you the same message. They said to tell Michael, please give some TLC to the PYTs. Now, I know that sounds a little off the wall, but you know what I mean.
During the ceremony, Jackson spoke a total of 13 words at the event. Quote, I'm very, very honored. Thank you very much, Mr. President and Mrs. Reagan. In his diary entry for that Monday, Reagan made the following comments. A ceremony on the South Lawn to honor young Michael Jackson, who is the sensation of the pop music world, believed to have earned $120 million last year. He is giving the proceeds of one of his biggest selling records to the campaign against drunk driving. He is totally opposed to drugs and alcohol, and is using his popularity to influence young people against them. I was surprised how shy he is. Although Michael Jackson was aligned on Reagan's war on drugs policy position, it is unclear whether Jackson would have voted for the Republican candidate. Although Michael and the Reagans remained friendly over the years, with Ronald and Nancy visiting MJ's Neverland Ranch and even staying the night. Soon after being recognized by the presidency, Michael Jackson used his influence to help in the famine crisis in Ethiopia by co-writing and partaking in the charity single We Are the World. It was the first time Jackson truly realized the power he held to have impact on global issues that could actually save lives. This positioning the singer as a powerful humanitarian force, which Jackson was questioned on in 1987.
Do you ever think about ever being an ambassador or anything like that? The fact that you're accepted around this whole world, you ever think about being some type of an ambassador?
I feel I'm that already with my music and what I've done with the music, because it breaks all barriers. I don't have to make a political statement. I do all of that with music.
Mm-hmm.
It breaks all language barriers and everything to all races of people. It goes all over the world.
Michael Jackson would continue to express his own philosophies in his music. For example, with tracks like Man in the Mirror or Abortion Papers that he worked on while recording his 1987 album Bad. In the latter, Michael expresses his own anti-abortion beliefs from the perspective of a desperate family member. The song was never officially released, due to the impact it may have had on his fan base. The lyrics reading, quote, those abortion papers, signing your name against the word of God, those abortion papers, think about life, I'd like to have my child. Michael did not intend for the song to bash those pro-choice, as he merely wanted to persuade them to follow Christian canons and find another way. The liner notes for the demo saying, quote, I have to do it in a way so I don't offend girls who have had gotten abortions or bring back guilt trips. So it has to be done carefully. I really have to think about it. This may or may not have been the first time Michael voiced his opinion on abortion, as he sings in his hit Wanna Be Starting Something, quote, if you can't feed your baby, then don't have a baby. However, it has been speculated that abortion papers didn't make the final cut due to Madonna releasing Papa Don't Preach, which revolved around similar themes. As the rumor states, the team behind Bad didn't want to look like they were copying their musical rival. Therefore, it wasn't released until 25 years later as part of the anniversary edition of Bad, causing controversy and sparking discussion on the King of Pop's political views. Michael Jackson would again return to the White House when he was honored on May 5, 1990 by President George H.W. Bush, who invited Jackson to congratulate him on being named Entertainer of the Decade by the Capitol Children's Museum in Washington. 2 years later, on May 1st, 1992, President Bush also presented Jackson with an award acknowledging him as a, quote, point of light ambassador. The award was in recognition to Jackson's efforts in inviting the disadvantaged and underprivileged kids to his ranch, as well as giving his time to visiting hospitals, orphanages, assisted living homes, and hospices. The following year, Michael also teamed up with former President Jimmy Carter to help immunize children in Los Angeles and Atlanta against preventable childhood diseases. Certainly not anti-vaccinations, the program conducted the most comprehensive immunization program ever mounted in the US, with 17,000 children immunized in just 5 days. By this time, Jackson had already established the Heal the World Foundation as a charitable organization, inspired by his single of the same name. Following the 1992 Los Angeles riots, Jackson donated $1.25 million to start a health counseling service for inner-city kids, suggesting that the King of Pop supported the expansion of social programs that Democrats would often be in support of. This affiliation with left-leaning causes only deepened when Michael performed at the inauguration of the Democratic leader, President Bill Clinton, in 1993. Jackson, as well as dozens of other performers, sang We Are the World at the Lincoln Memorial and drew hundreds of thousands of people to watch. Then Michael also performed at Clinton's inauguration gala, using his celebrity to bring global attention to the AIDS epidemic, notably through his friendship with activist Ryan White and his charitable efforts with Elizabeth Taylor. Michael therefore took the opportunity on stage to plead with the Clinton administration to give more money to combat HIV and AIDS, and performed his single, Gone Too Soon, a song dedicated to White. A distinctly political act and a comment on the previous administration, who refused to address the disease head on, failing to support causes related to AIDS and research into finding a cure. The 1990s saw Michael Jackson's music become more aggressive and politically pointed, with singles like Black or White, Scream, and They Don't Really Care About Us, calling out against racism, police brutality, and various injustices. In They Don't Really Care About Us, Michael Jackson sings, quote, both Roosevelt was living, he wouldn't let this be, no, no, referring to former Democratic President Franklin D. Roosevelt, who during the 1930s and 40s was a civil and workers' rights activist. His criticisms of policing, the justice system, free media, and vocal support for figures like Nelson Mandela and Martin Luther King may suggest that Jackson was in support of some kind of revolution of the people. This feeling made more profound by the army marching chant that is heard throughout the track. The overtly militant imagery portrayed in the teaser for his 1995 album History also caused controversy, an aspect Diane Sawyer grilled the pop superstar on during their primetime interview.
They say, among other things, that it is clearly modeled after Triumph of the Will, Leni Riefenstahl. A Nazi film with
not
Nazi
true. None of that's true.
You know what?
Nothing to do with politics or communism or fascism.
Well,
at all. That is not political. It's not fascist. It's not dogma. It's not, you know, ideology and all of this stuff. It's pure, simple love. You don't see any tanks. You don't see any cannons. It's about love.
Over his career, Michael Jackson was received by over 30 different world leaders, most likely a record for an entertainer. As while on tour, many nations treated his arrival almost like a state occasion. When he lived at the Neverland Ranch, on his coffee table, MJ kept pictures in frames of people he met who he'd admired. There were pictures of President and First Lady Reagan and the Clintons, as well as pictures of him with Elizabeth Taylor, Nelson Mandela, and the President of Czech, Václav Havel, Queen Elizabeth, Prince Charles, and Princess Diana, as well as many heads of states, countries, and royal families, suggesting that Michael was somewhat apolitical and just admired those in positions of power in any form. Michael Jackson's most overt political endorsement came in 2002 when he made his very last public performance for the Democratic National Committee fundraiser, A Night at the Apollo, in New York City, where he performed Dangerous and Heal the World. Former President Clinton remembers, quote, he basically saved my party from terrible financial distress, so he was very kind to me personally, adding, quote, he was an immensely gifted man, and I think he basically meant well. Maybe because of Michael's long-standing connection with the Clintons, or his rule not to speak publicly about politics, Jackson never endorsed or commented on the election of America's first black president, Barack Obama. Despite his previous outspokenness on issues of race, civil rights activist Al Sharpton commenting, "Way before Tiger Woods or Barack Obama, Michael made black people pop culture global." He attributing Obama's presidential win to, quote, "a process that Michael helped America graduate to, as crossover fans and imitators grew up to be voters." Despite Michael Jackson's contribution to American pop culture and his strides in breaking down racial barriers, when the King of Pop's sudden death shocked the world in June 2009, the Obama White House didn't release any kind of statement. Even though President Bush released a statement after the death of musician James Brown, and President Jimmy Carter doing the same for Elvis back in 1977. After a week of silence, President Obama was questioned about Jackson, in which the world leader gave a statement that both expressed his admiration for the singer, but also acknowledged the complexities of Michael Jackson's life.
You know, I think that Michael Jackson is will go down in history as one of our greatest entertainers. I grew up on his music, still have all his stuff on my iPod. You know, I think that his brilliance as a performer also was paired with a tragic and, in many ways, sad personal life. But, you know, I'm glad to see that he is being remembered primarily for the great joy that he brought to a lot of people through his extraordinary gifts as an entertainer.
What is unclear is how Michael Jackson may have voted if he was alive during the 2016 election, as he had alliances with both nominees Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. Michael indeed was loyal friends with Trump since the early 1990s, and the New York City real estate mogul continued to voice support for the singer for many years to come, unlike most of those in the public eye. Their friendship began when Trump offered the pop singer $1 million to make a single appearance at his brand new Taj Mahal casino. Jackson agreed and flew out to Atlantic City in the businessman's private jet, where he was personally paraded around the establishment by Trump, causing much commotion from the public and press alike. The two soon bonded after Jackson caught wind of the death of his friend Ryan White, and Trump agreed to fly out with the superstar to White's family home to pay their respects. From that point onwards, Michael would often stay at Trump Tower while in New York, go for dinner and the ballet with Donald and his family, often playing with his children when they were young, eventually hiding out in the high-rise after news broke of his marriage to Lisa Marie Presley in 1994. Up until 2003, they were still close friends and had dinner together, in which Michael wanted to mess with him and suggested to the future First Lady, Melania Trump, that they make out when he comes back. Of course, this didn't happen, but they giggled about it all night. Despite the King of Pop's relationship with the presidential nominee, it's unclear whether Michael would have agreed with him politically, often aligning himself with the very wealthy as a means to progress his business aspirations, whether through their guidance, connections, or investment. Alternatively, Jackson may have felt more comfortable with the mega-rich, as his own wealth and fame didn't faze them as much as others who would feel jealousy or would be intimidated by it. However, Jermaine Jackson, Michael's brother, made it clear telling TMZ the superstar would have hands down voted for the Democratic frontrunner in the 2016 presidential election. When asked whether Jackson was a big fan of Clinton, Jermaine replied, quote, "Of course, we're Democrats." Jermaine then lashed out at Hillary Clinton's political rival, Donald Trump, for comments the White House hopeful made about the entertainer earlier that year, Trump calling Michael Jackson, quote, "a very good friend" during a Republican town hall. Quote, "he was an unbelievably talented guy," Trump said, but, quote, "lost tremendous confidence because of, honestly, bad, bad, bad surgery."
He was an unbelievably talented guy. He lost his confidence, and he lost tremendous confidence because of, honestly, bad, bad, bad surgery. He had the worst. He had people that did numbers on him that were just unbelievable, facially and, you know, the plastic surgeons. But Michael was an unbelievable talent who actually lost his confidence.
Jermaine tweeting at the time, quote, "this fool Trump needs to sit down." When it comes to the current presidential race, it's anyone's guess. So if he was around, who do you believe Michael Jackson would vote for when it comes down to a rematch between former President Donald Trump and President Joe Biden?